We get it in our head as homeschool moms that we can do everything, and dads. You know, we want to cover all the bases, take care of all the topics, teach everything, get our kids to every activity known to man. We want to do it all. But what I encourage you to do is stop and slow down and take a breath and understand that when you have a child that has struggles, you are going to have to reprioritize. What I'm going to be talking to you about today is something that's very near and dear to my heart. And what I want to try to get across to you, the title of the topic is Homeschooling Everybody Else While You're Homeschooler, While You Try to Homeschool Your Struggling Learner. And I just want to open up with a quick word of prayer before I get started. Heavenly Father, we just love you, and I thank you for this day. I thank you for each person represented here. I thank you for this conference, and I thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to stand before you, Lord, and teach and speak. And I just pray, Lord, that your words would come out of my mouth, Lord, and that you would be honored in all that is said here. Lord, we just thank you for this time, and we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Just briefly, I am a homeschool mom of three. This is year 10 of homeschooling for me. I have a 14-year-old, a 12-year-old, and a 5-year-old, two boys and a girl. And so I decided to start homeschooling when my oldest was in kindergarten, and it was going to be a just one-year thing. Just we're going to homeschool this 1 year because I didn't really want to put my baby in kindergarten on a bus. And God really had a different plan for our family. He decided at that point to really start showing us that our young son, who's 12 now, had several different struggles learning-wise. And so God really took us on a journey that is where we are now. He, without going into a whole lot of details, has a lot of auditory and visual processing issues and is textbook very severely dyslexic. So he's got a full gamut of challenges, maybe more than, you know, a typical homeschool family might have in just one, but full gamut, like I said. So I could be talking in extremes for you, or, you know, you could also have more to deal with than what I have. So what we've done is, you know, we embarked on a journey to help him persevere through these challenges and try to help him be the best person that God, you know, is intending for him to be and equip him with everything that God wants for him to do. What I'm going to do today for this workshop is share some of my struggles and some of the tools that I use to help me teach all of my children more effectively. What I'm sure some of you know is that we get it in our head as homeschool moms that we can do everything. And dads, you know, we want to cover all the bases, take care of all the topics, teach everything, get our kids to every activity known to man. We want to do it all. That's our schedule, their schedule, our husband's schedules, our neighbor's schedules, everybody's schedules. But what I encourage you to do is stop and slow down and take a breath and understand that when you have a child that has struggles, you are going to have to reprioritize. You have to do things a little bit differently than you might have done. Can't necessarily teach every subject that you want to teach. You can't allow your kids necessarily to do every sport activity that they want to do. If you're going to do and teach your child that has struggles the way that he or she needs to be taught. So, what I suggest to start off with is that you make a list of goals and objectives for each child, not just your child that struggles, but that you make a list of goals and objectives for each child. You say, these are the things that I want. I have a son who plays football. It's something right now in his life that is a joy for him. And so for him, that's a priority. We put that on our list of goals and objectives as a priority for him. That's the only sport activity that he is doing right now, but that's a goal, a priority, an objective for that child. Different for my 5-year-old, different for my 12-year-old. But I would suggest getting some sort of a planner, a goal planner for each of your child, each of them, and setting up what those things are for them. That way you don't stray or deviate from what you think you want to do for those children. With the children that do not struggle, you're probably only going to sit down and do this once a year, maybe once a semester, once at the beginning of the school year, once you may regroup and do it again come January. With your child that struggles, I probably do this once a month, because what I learn is that for him, what may not be a hot button right now may completely change come when the weather changes and the allergies hit or different things that happen. So with that child that has struggles, you may have to regroup and reevaluate what your goals and objectives are much more frequently than you would with your other children. So from there, what I recommend, and this is for me where things got difficult, and that's why this is kind of passionate for me, is that I have pages and pages of things that I could do with my child that struggles. I have pages and pages of things that I want to do with my other children. You've got 24 hours in a day. There's only so many things you can do, and I think when we feel like that we are failing is when we can't get everything we want in the day that God's given us. So what I suggest you do is you get just a blank planner, and you mark off those things that are priority. Breakfast, lunch, dinner, chores, the basics. You get those things. You know, my son has to be at football practice at 5 o'clock. Obviously, I'm not going to be homeschooling probably during those times unless we've got a tape in the car that he's listening to. So once you get it on paper and you set those things on that goal and objective sheet that are priority for you, then you can mark out those times that you're not going to be teaching, which can be, this one has 30-minute segments. You may even want to get a calendar that's got 15-minute segments. Depending on what you're doing, you may need to block things out even smaller. And for each of you, the things that you put on there may be different. Like I said, for me, you know, I'm looking at things like football. I'm looking at, we do a family Bible study each day. Those are things that are mandatory for our house. Your meals are mandatory. We have certain chores that we do each day. Those are things that are our priorities. And you may be doing one of these, what they call time planners, for each day of the week, because your day might look different. We go outside the house on Tuesdays, and my kids take some classes. So those that day of the week is going to look completely different than the rest of them. So then from there, what you're going to do is you've got to determine what you need to personally teach each of your children. Mine are 14, 12, and 5. What I'm personally going to teach my 5-year-old is going to be completely different than what I'm going to personally teach my 14-year-old. Hopefully, if I've homeschooled to the best of my ability, my 14-year-old should be at a place where he's doing a fairly good job of self-teaching. I have equipped him over the years with the ability to teach himself, and we also utilize different classes, and I'm not going to teach him chemistry. He goes to a class and he gets chemistry there. So as he's gotten older, we've equipped him that way. So he needs less and less of my time at that point. My 5-year-old needs much more of my time because she's learning how to read. She's learning how, you know, the basics of math. So I have to be realistic in my head what all that's going to take. And I need to make sure that I've got an idea of how much time each of those things are going to take. Because you've got to be realistic. You know, if I'm unrealistic and I start marking up this page, I could easily say, well, it's going to take me 3 hours to teach my 5-year-old. It's going to take me 4 hours to teach my 12-year-old, and it's going to take me another 3 hours to teach my 14-year-old. And, you know, there's no day left. I haven't gotten the dishes done. Nobody's eaten lunch. You know, nothing's happened except for school. So I've got to be realistic, and I've got to understand that I can only do so much. I'm one person, and so I've got to address those subjects that are important, and I have to address those things that I'm going to teach that are those tasks. So then from there, you've got to, you want to look at opportunities to teach your kids in groups. I'm at a point with a 14, 12, and 5-year-old that I can't do that as well anymore. But when my boys, my 14 and my 12-year-old, were younger, I taught science and history together. My 12-year-old who struggled didn't get as much out of it as my 14-year-old does. But I was able to take those subjects and group them together, and they both got different things out of it, but it was successful. I can't do that as well now, but y'all certainly can if you've got children of like ages. You can pick those topics. Math's probably not one. You know, language arts is probably not one. But if you're doing handwriting, everybody can be doing handwriting at the same time. So you want to just be smart with your time so that when you need to be one-on-one, especially with that student that struggles, that you're productive and your other children are doing something that they can be working on by themselves. So that helps free up that time so that you can do that. So what you want to do is you want to take a list of what needs to be tutored with your other children first, okay? I need to know that it's going to take me maybe 30 minutes twice a day to teach my 5-year-old the phonics and reading section of what she's doing for school. That I put on my calendar, on my day planner first. I need to know that maybe my son, who's taking geometry, needs 20 or 30 minutes of my time to go through any questions that he's got. I put all of that down first. Put our family Bible study down, like I said. So then what's left over after I have scheduled my other two children are those chunks of time that are available to teach my son that struggles. Because if I don't do that, he is the type of child, based on where he is, he would take my whole day. And it's just not feasible, and it's not fair in the grand scheme of things to do that. I'm a mom of three, not a mom of one. And so I have to be able to give to the other two what they need, not just do what the child that struggles needs. Now, what has helped me, and I use this with both, is that, like I said, let's say I am teaching phonics. And I know that it's probably going to take me a certain amount of time to do that. I'm teaching her math. It's going to take me a certain amount of time to teach her the math, but she's also going to be doing, say, a workbook page to go along with it. And so what I do with my kids, even Brayton, who's the one that struggles, is I set up homework files. And these are just set up by day, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. And I put in these homework files the things that they're going to be doing during those times that they need to be occupied. And this is paper-wise. The other thing that I put in there are a list of activities, like say for her, that she can do that give me an idea that say, okay, she can play Play-Doh or she can do paper dolls, those kinds of things that she can do to keep herself occupied when she's not in one-on-one time with me, or when she's doing what we would call homework. So I will take and rip out those pages that she might have in a workbook or a handwriting page, and I put all of those things in the file for that day. So that then after I have tutored her through those things that she and I are going to do one-on-one, then she knows that she has got this. I give it to her, and we go through what she's going to do because she's smaller. Go through what she's going to do, and she sits next to me, and we do those things. I do the same thing, and I'll go through this here in a minute, with my son that struggles. He has the same kind of thing, that he has papers and files like this to keep him occupied so that he's not going, Mom, Mom, I got a question about this. Mom, 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 I've got a question about that. So this is a good tool that has freed us up to be able to operate a little smoother, I guess. So basically, that, in a nutshell, takes care of my other two. I'm one-on-one with her a little more than I am with my older student. And I can show you, too. I break up my day to where And this changes just depending on what we're doing, but I break up my day based on the time that I'm going to spend with each child. So we do devotions in that first thing in the morning, and then from there, my day is broken up depending on which child I'm spending it with, so that I know, say, from 8 to 8:30, Paige and I are going to be working together. And it's not necessarily, depending on what we're doing, I don't have this set in stone as to what I'm going to do with her specifically yet. I haven't put together, we're not going to start homeschool for a couple weeks, so I don't have exactly right now what I'm going to do with her, but I try to keep that pretty structured so that, especially my boys like to know what's coming. They don't want that to be questioned. So that sets my day up so that I know who I'm working with. At my house, if I'm working with Paige and it's not a life or death question, my other two don't come and ask me a question right then and there. I mean, if it's something that they can say, I can't find a piece of paper, do you know where it is? That's fine. But we try not to interrupt what we call our one-on-one or tutor time as much as possible, because that was getting to be an issue. So, in the past, it has been very hard to feel like we accomplished anything, because my son that struggles is so very needy in that realm. And some of these things have really helped to make him feel more independent, to make him a more independent learner, to where that he can work separate from me and accomplish things. Before, he might be separate, but he wasn't really accomplishing anything. One of the biggest things that I'm not here to tell you to pick a certain curriculum or anything like that, but for our family, one of the biggest things that we started this year for this child is a program called Switched On Schoolhouse. And the reason why we picked it up is because, like I said, this son is a severe dyslexic. His reading is one of his biggest issues. Up until about a year and a half ago, very little reading. But he's 12. And so he's wanting this information that he's not getting the way a normal student would get from a textbook or from materials. And so he was getting it from me. I'm reading the books to him. I'm giving him this information. And so there was so much one-on-one time that it was generating struggles, and mom's tired and mom doesn't want to be with that child anymore because she spent all day with them. What Switched On Schoolhouse does is it reads the material to them. There is a tool within Switched On Schoolhouse that allows the student to highlight the material and it reads it. Now, it does not read the questions that go along with it. This is also, they don't necessarily have to write anything down if they don't want to with the Switched On Schoolhouse. But you can download a program called Natural Reader, and it's just naturalreader.com, and it's a free reading tool. And you can take it and it'll go in and they can highlight, once it's on the computer, they can highlight the other things that Switched On Schoolhouse won't read, like test questions. You know, he takes the test right online, and it'll go through and read the test questions for him. It won't obviously answer it, but it gives him that freedom. What we were running into is that he could read the material, but then we'd get to the questions, and he'd say, Mom, I need you to come read this for me. And so we were kind of right back where we started from, and what this natural reader will do, like I said, is you highlight it, and it'll read all that for him. And it was amazing to see the change for him in his, the way he felt, the sense of accomplishment, so that he could sit there and he could get through that work. And he was learning, you know, really interesting information in science and math, or science and history and Bible. He was learning that information, and it has become a really interesting tool for him. And like I said, I'm not trying to tell you that I think you should buy that. I'm just saying for us, it was, you know, you have stepping stones. I mean, this was a full staircase jump for us. So, and it's not cheap, but you can buy one subject. And what we do is I block out times of the day that he works on that. So when he's independent, he may do history during that time, or he may do science during that time. Now, and you can use that. You can still, let's say, you know, you've got a science curriculum that you want to use with your kids. Doesn't mean that you can't still do that. That just gives you a tool for your child to use that to learn and be independent. And it's, like I said, it's amazing to see him talk about these things that he's learning in these subjects that he wouldn't have been learning unless I would have sat down at the book and read it for him. So, like I said, for us, that's a big tool. Secondly, is, like I said, this homework file. This was another huge thing for him. And what I do with this, and you can use it any way you want, I go back and I use remedial work a lot of times with this. Like I said, reading's been an issue for him, so I found some, this is just Steck Vaughn, they work for us. They're reading comprehension books, and we started even with grade one. And we went back and I pulled pages of these out and stuck them in there, and he would go and he'd do the reading comprehension with this, because at that point he was equipped to read through these with where he was with his reading. But like I said, so that, you know, he's not staring at a book that said first grade on it, I pulled them out of the book and stuck them in the folder, and that became homework for him. And so he's able to sit down and complete. And like I said, what we would do is I would say to him, if you can't answer the question, you move on. And when we get to the time where mom's one-on-one with you, if you don't know how to get the answer to that question, then we'll sit down and work through it. And so that, too, gave him that opportunity for independent learning. And there's all kinds of this stuff out there. There's, the other thing that I have done is made my own math worksheets and just put whatever it is that you're trying to work with them on math-wise in there as far as the sheet goes. So the sky is really the limit as to what you can put in that homework file for them. And I give him a checklist to where it says, you have to complete these three pages when you're finished, check it off. So that he's got a sense of accomplishment, and he's not going, Mom, what do I do next? Mom, what do I do next? Which is what he's done all along, and I've allowed it. You know, the sad part of all of it is that I've equipped him to be this way. And I just didn't know how to make him feel like he could function by himself. And so, you know, they're able to do it if we can just give them the right tools to do it. So, you know, you've got those things that you're working on with them. Now what you've got to decide is, what are all those extra things that you do need to teach him? Like I said, for us, this child struggles with reading. And so there are lots of topics that go along with that that he struggles with. Writing is one. Handwriting is another. And so we spend a lot of our tutoring time doing all those things. Now, I could fill probably 2 pages of a notebook with activities and things that I know that I can do with him that I have been taught over the last few years. What you've got to do is you can't do all those things all the time. You know, you can't work from, you can't do a certain kind of writing. You can't do all of those things at the same time. So you got to sit down and decide what your priorities are. That goes back to your list of objectives that you have for that child. And so you want to set objectives for a month or a quarter for that student. And say, like for example, for us, we have found good success with him in teaching him how to write by using a program. We use Wordly Wise. We take the story, he writes it, or he draws it on paper, then he takes and he writes, or he tells it back to me, and then he writes it. Can't do that all in one day. It takes too long. And besides the fact, he can't sit still for more than about maybe 30, 40 minutes. So you've got to decide, okay, how important is this? How many pieces of this puzzle do I want to cover? Maybe I'm going to do this twice a week. And I'm going to do half of it one day and half of it another. Or if this is important, maybe you're going to do it 3 times a week. So you got to decide what it is that's important. Otherwise, you're going to get bogged down with the fact that I just can't do it because I've got a list of 15 things that I know I want to do with him, but I just can't do it. I have talked to several of you about the fact that this child in math facts, we teach them and teach them and teach them. He learns them for a while and then they go void again. Here you go. I'm sorry. And so we've got to decide, okay, maybe every other month are we going to visit math facts. Maybe one month we're going to do it one way, the next month we're going to do it the next way. But I can't bang my head against this child when it's just not working right at the moment. So you visit it for a little while and then you come back to it. And so those are those things on your goals and objectives that you say, okay, for 2 weeks I'm going to work on math facts, or for 2 weeks I'm going to work on sight spelling words, or for this amount of time I'm going to work on those things. And only you really know what those things are that you need to be doing. My list is going to be completely different than your list depending on where your children are and what it is that is important. And this also may be an area where you need some help. I mean, I have sat down with somebody and gotten some feedback as to what needs to be my priorities, because sometimes you can't figure that out. And so I suggest you do that. You know, you get together with, we have a tutor that we use, and we talk through those things. Other homeschool moms that have students that struggle, and kind of get an idea of what those orders are that have worked for them. So for us, that makes, that helps us to take care of all that. Now then, there are lots of other things. So you've got your things that you're working on that are helping that child move ahead, but then that doesn't take up your whole school day. And if your child that struggles is like mine, he needs to be occupied all the time. I mean, he just needs to be occupied. He is my child that will clean the bathroom 3 times a day if I let him, joyfully. I mean, but he needs to be occupied with something to do. He's just, he needs his hands or his mind occupied with something. So you say, okay, what else am I going to do with these students that struggle? And for me, like I said, with his issues being a lot of reading and those kinds of things, we've had to go to other media, like I said, with the computer, to get him that information. So the first thing that I recommend, or one thing that has really freed us up over the last about year and a half, is books on tape. And they're expensive to go and buy. Depending on what the issues your children have, there is an organization called the Recordings for the Blind and Dyslexic, www.rfbd.org. And they will, you join, I think it was $35, they just sent me my renewal to join. What was expensive with them is you had to go and get a machine to play their recordings. What they've just started doing is you're able to take these books on tape and download them to MP3, which is huge. So you go onto their website, you pick, you know, Henry Huggins by Beverly Cleary or whatever it might be, you download those books. He or she listens to it at whatever rate they want. You delete the book when you're finished. I don't remember how many books you can download at a time, but you're not only, you can, you know, fiction, nonfiction, anything that you want this child to hear is, I haven't found too much Christian, like textbooks and that kind of thing, but they do have textbooks that are on there. And, what is happening is there's more and more available in this MP3 format. Not everything's available at that. At this point, when we started, we had to buy the tape player, or it's a CD player. That was about $200 to actually listen to the CDs, which in my opinion is still worth it, because I'm giving him that information. And the player will help you. There's a method on there to slow the person talking down or speed the person up. So we still use that sometimes. I'm sorry? It's www.rfbd.org. When I joined, and like I said, it's been, I can't remember whether we're 2 years or just a year, When we joined, we bought the player. And so I think with everything, it was like $250. But like I said, when they, I think it was January or February, they began to do this to where they are now, the books are on MP3. Uh-huh. You know, it is amazing. The more you put in, the more they're going to start remembering. Sometimes. And, you know, I talked to some about that. You know, another thing that you're going to want to do with that time that they are, you know, going, Mom, what's next? Is pick up things that are going to help train that processing. And like I said, we have had pretty good success. I don't, you know, not everybody does, but with, you know, aerobics, it's worked for him. It's been a good tool to help with that. And there's lots of other things you can do with those books on tape. You know, Jonathan Park, I don't know if y'all are familiar with that. I mean, that's one of his favorites. And it's interesting to me, he was talking the other day about something. I don't listen to them very much. And he was talking about some sort of adventure, something or other. And I'm like, what are you talking about? He's like, Mom, Jonathan Park and this and that. And so I think we don't realize how much they really do pick up, especially when it's interesting. You know, especially when it's that kind of thing that's interesting for them. And now what I'm saying is, you know, I'm not suggesting that you leave them listening for huge lengths of time. You know, you may set him or her down for 15 or 20 minutes so that, you know, they don't take off into another world and it's there and they're not listening to it. So make sure that it's a clear, concise, shorter amount of time that you're doing it at first, as far as the auditory goes. On the other end, we are, and I mean, the convention hall is full of amazing, interesting things on video, not, you know, Disney or what have you, that not just that kind of thing, but I mean, there is amazing creation materials. There's just some really good video information that you can give them. And I know Netflix we don't have that, but I've got some friends that are using that with their homeschool too, to where they're getting different biographies and that kind of thing on Netflix, to where they download that. I think there's a Christian version of that too. I'm not 100% certain. But and video, this all is expensive, but you know, keep in mind they make good Christmas presents. You know, grandma doesn't know what to buy them for Christmas, and so, you know, that's something fun for them to do. Drawing has been an area that we have just really started visiting. We've realized that he has not, I mean, he's a very poor flat drawer. And so you can take that time to do those kinds of things. You know, these Draw Right Now books, there's other, if you're looking at time alone, these are great tools. There's other things out there that you can use to teach them drawing that then they can apply when they are, when you're tutoring them versus when they're just doing some sort of an activity while you're with the other kids. And then obviously, you know, the computer programs, not just the learning ones. My son loves anything that's related to computer, and so there's KidCAD programs out there where they can design and build things. Whatever, you know, their hot button might be, there's some interesting things that are out there that in moderation, and obviously any of this media you want to do in moderation, is good ways for them to get information. And you know, last but not least, we don't want to forget that these kids need outside. They need to be outside. They need things like trampolines. They need things like balls and bikes and chalk and just, you know, fresh air. My son really deals with lights and the noise that comes from them. And so, you know, it's almost a soothing process to send him outside, even for 10 or 15 minutes. So if you're in a place where you can send them outside, you know, depending on how old they are, without going with them, or everybody can take a break for 15 minutes and go outside, a couple of them, while you're tutoring with one, then, you know, please don't hesitate to do that. So you've got all these tools. The last thing that you want to make sure you do is you teach them how to stay organized. You give them that sheet that you have printed off for them, and, you know, depending on where they are, you may have to try to print on the side of their, or make a picture of the book that they're doing, you know, depending on what their struggles are. You know, if they can't read, that it says, you know, draw right now book, you know, give them a tool that's what's next, so that they're, you're equipping them to check a list off, just like I would my older son, that I give him a schedule of, you know, you're going to do this and you're going to do that, so that then you're equipping them to be task oriented, which is what, you know, if they go out into the workforce, they're going to have to be that way at some point in time. They're going to have to make a list of things that they do for their job or their work, and they're going to have to be able to get them done. And so you want to equip them so that they can do that. And there's no better place or time to do it or start, you know, than right now. And, you know, keep in mind that the best thing that you can do is keep a notebook and write down things that you're doing that are good, things that you're doing that are bad, struggling days. Why are they struggling days? Is it raining outside? What's going on? Why is what is happening? You know, if it's a really good day or it's a really good week, why? What have you done? What's happened to make things better or worse for that child? And it may be that, you know, you're using a certain tool that's just not working anymore for now, and you need to leave it behind. You know, this, you know, if I'm using this program and it's not working right now, then I need to say, okay, it's time to put it down, because, you know, we're butting heads, we're fighting, it's just not working. So we need to be willing to do all of those things so that we're successful and that we're making them successful. So that's really the basis of what I was hoping to share with y'all today. So if you have questions, I'd happily answer them. I've got lots of different materials that you can look at if you like, but I appreciate your time today.